Hi, everyone. Thank you for being here at our presentation, Linguistics at the Service of Language Revitalization, the Ktunaxa Way. I'm going to start by giving a very brief overview of where this talk is going, and then we'll introduce ourselves and the plan for the talk. So we're here to talk about a mutual capacity building workshop called Linguistics at the Service of Language Revitalization, the Ktunaxa Way. That workshop is organized by the community and the Department of Linguistics at UBC. It is intended for linguists and community members that are involved in Ktunaxa language work. And what it aims to accomplish is to foster dynamic and transparent relationships between all people involved in language work, and to create a shared experience in language work, and finally to develop perspective on the language that are informed both by Ktunaxa ways of knowing and by linguistic ways of knowing.
We would like to welcome you to the Ktunaxa traditional territory. Hugaklik Chrystal Williams, Hunini Ktunaxa, Hugaki, Gachi, Akam. I am Chrystal Williams, I am Ktunaxa, and I am from Akam. I am the work with the Language and Culture Department for Akam.
Kiso Kikit, Hukaklik Sonya Morigeau, Hunini Ktunaxa, Hukaki Gachi Akam. I am the Akshuk Akum, Akakish Hakum Manager. I'm the Language and Culture Manager here at Akam.
And I am Bertrand. I'm a PhD student in the Department of Linguistics at UBC. I am currently located in Vancouver, where I am an uninvited settler on the traditional Coast Salish people's territory, specifically the Tsleil-Waututh, Squamish, Stolos, Tuminus, and Musqueam people.
We would like to say Hustukashkulkani, thank you to the participants, the elders, the speakers, learners, teachers, linguists, and language champions that help us proceed with our work. We would also like to thank SHRC for the connection grant that has funded this workshop.
So here's a roadmap of the talk. So we're going to start by introducing some information about the Ktunaxa language. Then we'll be discussing the history of the partnership between Akam and UBC Linguistics and how we're trying to reshape the partnership with this workshop that we are holding right now. And then we'll finish by discussing anticipated outcomes and the next steps.
The Ktunaxa language is an isolate language with communities in Canada and the United States. First Peoples Cultural Council in the report in 2018 recorded that we have 31 fluent speakers in Canada. We are unsure of the numbers of fluent speakers in the United States. And we have many more learners coming up. The language is taught in two sister schools located in Iakanuki and Akam. It is also taught in the middle school in Lori Middle School and located in Akiskatliet. There are adult classes that are given from Akam and Iakanuki. Also at the College of the Rockies, there's a Ktunaxa 101 class, and in Vancouver, there is a Ktunaxa language urban project. There are several other projects being developed as we speak.
So now we're going to discuss the partnership between Akam and UBC Linguistics. But before that, we're going to discuss the language plan the community has in place.
So our vision statement says, Usmek ga aksmak neknasha, tia kak in imash ganakiti, which means a vibrant, healthy community speaking our language, governing effectively, and maximizing our lands and resources for the benefit of all living things and future generations in a manner consistent with ganakiti, which is our values and principles. A prepared community, kakinish witi yasha, which is our thinking in our strategic plan, aksukakum akekish hakum, language and culture. Our goal is fluent Ktunaxa speakers with strong cultural skills and knowledge, along with 7 objectives. 4 of the objectives coincide with the work that we are doing right now, which is ensure the language is effectively taught in education centers, make the language lessons and resources easily accessible to all learners, fully support and honor fluent speakers, learners, and teachers, and continue to record and document the language. We also have our language speakers and knowledge holders group made up of 13 participants from the community. Within our Department of Language and Culture, our department grew from 3 individuals in 2013 to 6 now here in 2020. It includes language teachers, archivists, and administrative staff, organizes language and culture events. We oversee grant applications related to language and culture projects, constitutes the liaison between the community and UBC linguists, along with supporting the partnership with the UBC linguists.
So now we're going into how the relationship between UCCAM and UBC linguistics came to be. So it is greatly due to 2 individuals. So in 2010, Martina Wiltschko, a professor at the Department of UBC, Department of Linguistics at UBC, approached the Ktunaxa Nation because she wanted to teach a field methods course on Ktunaxa. And that led to Violet Birdstone, who is a speaker from UCCAM, who is currently based in Vancouver, who accepted to become the consultant for those field methods courses. And then the reason why Vi accepted to work in that context was because she thought it was a good thing for the language to be documented and preserved in a higher institution. But I think more importantly, there were 2 factors. So the context, like the field methods classes are traditionally quite small, which allowed for a private sharing experience. And then we do hyper-targeted research in linguistics, and Martina's approach was to, and the student's approach was to embed this hyper-targeted research on grammatical structure in cultural documentation. So to use Ktunaxa legends, for instance, to introduce grammar notions. At the end of the field methods course, students wanted to keep working with different speakers, and it was thanks to Vi's recommendation that students were able to start working with people in the community. And it is because Vi had this personal connection to her own community that this relationship and this partnership evolved. So between 2010 and 2020, several scholarly papers on different aspects of the Ktunaxa grammar were published in either conference proceedings or as part of the program requirements for students. And in parallel to this, so students were doing research and teaching materials were created on the basis of that research and then sent to the community. It was essentially this model of a partnership where the community would provide an infrastructure and speakers and knowledge holders would share their knowledge, and the language that was shared was elicited through the very narrow lens of formal linguistics, so what we call normally linguist sentences that can be extremely useful for documentation and analysis, but are not always so useful for teaching the language. So eventually linguists would take this documentation and transform it into teaching materials that would go back to the community to be used in the schools. One important aspect of this kind of partnership is that the language community and its relationship and perspective on the language and the community language itself were not part of this research model. And more so, the information flowed into like one single direction from the community to that specific formal language to the community, the linguistics community, and back to the community. So there's always an intermediary between in that research process. that was the linguistics community. Eventually in 2018, there was a memorandum of understanding that was signed by ACAM and UBC Linguistics, and those are the principles that are found in that MOU.
So the guiding principles for the MOU that helped us work towards our new partnership is community-based and participatory research that addresses the revitalization and preservation of the Ktunaxa language and works towards the goals of the Gakanishwitiyasa and objectives and the language and of the language and culture TP pole plan, which was built by the ACAM community and helps to relate the actualization of the ACAM and Ktunaxa vision statement. The community-based research refers to an approach to research that brings together a full range of research methods, methodologies, and frameworks. With the community from the inception of a project and is articulated between the relationship between the community and the researcher.
So the MOU calls us to reshape the partnership in following this schema here on the screen, where knowledge flows from the language community to the linguistics community and vice versa, without going through this formal language lens. Then formal and community perspectives inform which language is documented and studied. And then the community has direct access to the language as it is seen through the lens of linguistics. So instead of going through this process of teaching, of creating teaching materials and spitting out the documentation, the idea is that the community can engage directly with the research. And then finally, this dynamic partnership is only possible if the relationship between the community and its language are valued, is valued and recognized as a keystone of any and all language work, including formal research and documentation.
Reshaping the partnership. What tools do we need to build a partnership that supports community-based research, and what do we need to learn? For linguists, the creation story as a guide, Ganakitsi, Kaknishwitiyasha, identifying needs and interests in the community, and for community members, an introduction to linguistic fieldwork, which includes a methodology and a way of asking questions. Common ground, a sense of connection, a shared perspective, a shared experience, and a dialogue, mutual capacity building.
So now we're going to talk really quickly about how the workshop allows us to move towards a different partnership model and how we're answering the questions that were just given previously. So the workshop itself is, as we've said already, funded through a Sure Connection grant. We started thinking about this in 2018. It took us a year to come up with this idea, to come up with a final plan. We applied for a grant in May 2019, and it was awarded in June 2019. It was originally supposed to take place in person, but of course, with restrictions tied to COVID-19, it is now taking place online through weekly one-hour sessions, running from November to March. There are four modules in those sessions. So the first one is essentially what we did before Christmas, was to explore Ktunaxa ways of knowing. And then we moved on to linguistics ways of knowing. That was two sessions. Then because this is an experience in community-based research, we are conducting small research projects over the course of 8 sessions. And then we will be finishing with presentations and a round of gratitude. So we're currently in the research project phase of this project, of this workshop. Then to develop common ground, and I think that was a fundamental part of the workshop, we talked about what we call language trajectories, which are essentially sharing one's personal history of the relationship with the language, so the kind of exposure that one has gotten and the context in which that exposure was gotten, the personal goals with the language in general and for specifically the workshop, and then challenges and fears that may interfere with those goals, and of course motivations. And the way we did those language trajectories is that we asked three people to share their personal language trajectory in the big group, and then we went into breakout rooms where participants to the workshop were able to share their own language trajectories. And afterwards, we came back and were able to see where participants overlap and where they diverge, such that we can create a dialogue in the within those differences.
So we began the first module, the Ktunaxa Ways of Knowing, with sharing the creation story, the Ktunaxa creation story. And Ganakitsi, which is our rules of how we treat each other, and the Gakanetluitiasa, our thinking, our plan, our strategic plan, and the ways of being with each other, like being respectful, thoughtful, and accepting. We always want to share everything with humor, laughter, and fun. We talked about how descriptive the language is and the creativity of the elders to adapt the language to new realities and technologies, and about how each animal and living thing has a name, spirit, and purpose.
Then we moved on to linguistics ways of knowing, and what we tried to do was to show how linguistic methodology is similar to the path that one may follow when they're learning a new language. So the methodology pieces that we shared were contrast and minimal pairs, the relevance of positive and negative evidence, and then using visual support to elicit structures in the language specifically. And we emphasized the fact that eliciting negative evidence is essentially making mistakes on purpose, and that making mistakes is important as it teaches us about the rules in the language. So as a learner, we make mistakes quite often, and as linguists, we make mistakes on purpose. So this is the same process. And then we talked about how to ask questions such that their answers are informed by hypotheses. They highlight contrast in the language, and again, they elicit positive and negative evidence. And again, we liken this to what happens when you're learning a language and you make a mistake. And making mistakes means that you have assumptions and hypotheses about how the language works. And these assumptions and hypotheses can serve to structure and shape the questions that we ask when doing language documentation.
So three kinds of questions that came up with the language research is the grammar, applied grammar, and pedagogy.
So for research projects, in our groups of 4 to 5 participants, we had 1 or 2 fluent speakers, 1 or 2 linguists, 2 or 3 community members, and every week, groups shared what they have learned at the end of each session, along with the notes shared by email. Language resources will be created by each group based on what they have learned.
Expected outcomes are experiential, capacity building, documentation, and language resources.
And with respect to the partnership, we think that what we're accomplishing right now is building capacity for community members to engage with formal perspective on the language through understanding the methodology. And then at the same time, we're building capacity for linguists to engage with the community language. I think we have achieved providing a space to create more dynamic relationships between the two communities. So linguists and community members are engaging in different kinds of configurations than they were before.
Also the research based, so we're moving towards the model where the community is becoming more involved and foundational, providing the space for these relationships to develop and grow.
So what's next? When restrictions are lifted, we want to put together another workshop based on what participants want to accomplish. We want to include more participants and ensure the work keeps gaining visibility with presentations in communities and schools. At this time, we would like to thank you for listening to our presentation.
Anwenicket.
Anwenicket.